Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Resistors, How Ordinary Jews Fought Persecution in Hitler's Germany, by Wolf Gruner, narrated by David Colacci. Preface. In July 2008, by mere coincidence and only weeks before I moved to Los Angeles, I found the first trace of an individual Jewish resistor in an entry of a Berlin police logbook labeled as a political incident. Police had arrested a Berlin Jew who spoke up against the persecution. I had studied the Nazi persecution of the German Jews intensively for 20 years, but I had never heard of anything like it. This discovery revealed that despite widespread assumptions among Holocaust scholars, Jewish agency and resistance can be unearthed in perpetrator documents, such as police reports and court proceedings. It settled an academic trajectory that started with research on institutions in Nazi Germany, later investigating a diversity of contradictory local and national policies, and then exploring their impact on the Jewish population. Now I began to focus on the reactions and agency of the German and Austrian Jews toward the persecution. I always had an interest in understanding the impact of the Nazi persecution on Jewish individuals, and used testimonies and conducted interviews with survivors in Germany, Austria, the United States, and Bolivia for my dissertation. However, the victims were not front and center in my academic work, which concentrated on understanding why and how the persecution policies evolved. During a postdoctoral fellowship at Yad Vashem in Jerusalem in 1998, Yehuda Bauer and I discussed my research in a conversation. He challenged my scholarly approach by asking, "Where are the victims in your narrative?" It took a dozen years of systematic and intensive research to locate the sources and finally write this book about individual Jewish resistance against the Nazi persecution. As mentioned, it all started in early summer 2008, when I browsed through dozens of dusty police diaries looking for traces of the persecution of the Jews. I discovered police officers' handwritten notes about lost keys, stolen bicycles, drunk people, damaged property, and even apprehended exhibitionists. One day, one entry with the title "Political Incident" caught my eye. A police officer wrote about the arrest of a Jew who had protested anti-Jewish Nazi policies. Although the note was brief, offering little more than name, birth date, and address of the arrestee, plus a brief description of place, time, and general content of the protest, it struck me. At the time, most historians would have denied the possibility that Jewish individuals ever protested in public. However, I soon encountered dozens of similar cases, all labeled by the police officers as political incidents or political offenses. Those unexpected discoveries fundamentally shattered my established scholarly beliefs after decades of Holocaust research. Historians, including myself, had painted a picture of passivity of the persecuted. As discrimination in Nazi Germany gradually increased, the Jews slowly adapted, so went the argument. More generally, the assumption still exists today. Nikolaus Voxmann, for example, in his book K.L., A History of the Nazi Concentration Camps, 2015, said that defiance is rare in totalitarian regimes. The opposite seems true. Since I grew up behind the Iron Curtain in East Germany, the evidence resonated deeply with me on a personal level. My experience of living in a dictatorship until the age of 29 provided me with a distinct acuity. Having been part of the cultural underground in East Berlin, my intimate knowledge of the varieties of dissident behavior, which often resulted in grave repercussions for the individual and his or her family and friends, made me intensely aware how the communist regime perceived and punished even mild expressions of individual defiance as resistance. Since the persecution in Nazi Germany was so much more brutal, how much more serious must the regime have judged and punished any acts of opposition coming from their racial enemy number one, the Jews. Knowing many people who opposed the communist government in different ways, I realized it was improbable that German Jewish men and women would not have reacted with defiance and protest to Nazi discrimination policies. Next, I dug through 2,000 court cases in the Berlin archive. Although I did not find any names from the police files in the special court, Sondergericht records, a number of new files on Jewish protest and defiance surfaced. They were again rather brief, often solely containing either an indictment or a judgment, 3 to 5 typescript pages long. Yet they would tell us a bit more about the act of resistance and the circumstances, as well as the profession and biography of the defendants. Berlin was home to the largest Jewish community in Nazi Germany, and often praised as a refuge for Jews because of its size and the potential for anonymity. Both of these factors could have enabled more resistance in the capital. Hence, I expanded my search to see if I could find similar evidence of individual Jewish protest in other places of the former German Reich. During the next years, while teaching at the University of Southern California, I spent my summer breaks in the cities of Hamburg, Frankfurt, Munich, Leipzig, and Vienna, conducting research in local archives. Unexpectedly, they offered similar rich findings about individual Jews and their protest or defiance. I combed through thousands of perpetrator documents, including police reports, Gestapo files, and prison records, as well as indictments, proceedings, and judgments from half a dozen special courts. Those sources show that Jewish Germans frequently disobeyed Nazi regulations and protested in public against the persecution, despite the imminent danger of denunciations by non-Jewish Germans and subsequent harsh punishments. It was never a lack of resources, but our wrong assumptions that prevented us from detecting traces of individual Jewish resistance. Evidence of how Jews actively responded in many other ways to Nazi measures also surfaced. Some of them were prosecuted by regular local and regional courts for their acts. I visited the Yad Vashem Archive in Jerusalem and the United States Holocaust Memorial Museum Archives, which house copies of files from many German cities and towns. To complement and balance the documentation based on perpetrator files, I added a thorough examination of survivor testimonies. In these more than 170 video interviews from the Shoah Foundation Visual History Archive at the University of Southern California, some of the interviewees confirmed what I discovered in the archives, and some provided astounding stories of other types of undocumented individual resistance. A sabbatical granted by the University of Southern California in 2017-2018 gave me the time to start writing the first chapters. Ironically, the global pandemic, which changed the course of so many lives for the worse, prevented any travel in 2020, giving me the opportunity to finish the manuscript. This book aims to change the prevailing perspective of passive German Jews during the Holocaust by emphasizing their agency and illuminating the great variety of resistance acts revealed in archival documents and survivor testimonies. Introduction. In early spring 1941, Hertha Reiss, a 36-year-old forced laborer in the Nazi capital, was evicted by a judge along with her son and her mother from the two sublet rooms in which they lived. Outside of the Berlin courthouse, she exclaimed in front of passers-by, "We lost everything. Because of this cursed government, we finally lost our home, too. This thug Hitler, this damned government, these damned people. Just because we are Jews, we are discriminated against." Speaking out against the persecution of the Jews in broad daylight in the capital of the Third Reich after 8 years of Nazi rule hitherto seemed unimaginable, especially for an ostracized Jewish woman. But the story of Hertha Reiss and many other astonishing tales of individual defiance and courage contradict the common perception of an overwhelmingly passive or even fatalistic reaction among the Jewish population oppressed by Nazi Germany. This book offers a compendium of forgotten stories that changes our view of the past by illuminating unbelievable yet true accounts of individual resistance hidden in archives since the war ended. The protagonists of this book are ordinary Jewish men and women in Nazi Germany. Because they resisted persecution, the Nazis called them impudent Jews. These ordinary Jewish men and women found the courage to rebel despite a continuous barrage of discriminating and dehumanizing measures. Their brave acts challenge us to revise our image of victims of mass violence and to unearth the buried history of individual human resistance in times of growing authoritarianism and genocide. Although many survivors interviewed after the war revealed defiant individual behavior, none of them perceived their actions as resistance, since they were not armed and not members of organized groups. Neither did Max Mannheimer, a 20-year-old forced laborer at a road construction site in Bohemia in 1940, when he wrote in his diary, "My home is in a wooden hut behind the tool shed. From there I go to the public park, despite the 8 p.m. curfew and despite the ban on visiting the park. On my way I count the signs with the slogan, 'Forbidden for Jews.' In total there are 6. Later, at 11 p.m., I rip the signs out of the ground and throw some of them in the bushes, some in the creek. However, all my courage proved futile. The next evening, all the signs had reemerged. For a second time, I do not have the courage. I am just not a hero." Even though he downplays his actions, he broke Nazi laws again during his second visit, twice, by violating the curfew for Jews and the prohibition on visiting the park. Although it was important enough for him to write about it in his diary, Mannheimer did not find this resistance worth mentioning in his interview for the University of Southern California Shoah Foundation in 1996. With the notable exception of a few scholars, for example, Konrad Kvit, Helmut Eschwege, Marion Kaplan, and David Engel, most historians seem to dismiss or are unaware of verbal criticism and protests by individual German Jews in public, as well as other open acts of defiance, such as sabotage in the workplace or challenging the Nazis with a written protest. I have amended Yehuda Bauer's widely cited definition of Jewish resistance to read, "any individual or group action in opposition to known laws, actions, or intentions of the Nazis and their collaborators." Expanding the definition to include individuals, not just groups, fundamentally changes our perception and honors a wide range of Jewish acts of contestation, whether successful or unsuccessful, including protesting in public and breaking anti-Jewish rules. The definition provides us with both a broader perspective and a sharper lens, enabling us to uncover how Jews frequently responded during the Holocaust. With a changed lens, photographs and resistance. This new lens changes our view of familiar images and even enables the rediscovery of photographs taken by Jews as acts of resistance. When the victims took pictures to document the persecution and their effects, they broke the Nazis' authority over the imagery of the Third Reich and produced evidence of the crimes. If one starts to search, more and more pictures surface, taken by Jews as acts of contestation. During the nationwide Nazi boycott of Jewish stores, as well as law and medical practices on April 1, 1933, Jews documented anti-Jewish propaganda harming their businesses. In Stuttgart, 22-year-old Lisa Einstein photographed the entrance of her family's apartment building where members of the Sturmabteilung, SA, had defaced her father's business plaque by posting leaflets with the word Jew over it. One well-known image shows the respected Jewish lawyer Michael Siegel in Munich in March 1933. The Nazis had humiliated him by cutting off his pants legs and forcing him to parade barefoot through the city center. The picture appears in many books on Nazi Germany and usually serves to illustrate the first terror wave after Hitler came to power. However, a closer look reveals that Siegel did not experience random stormtrooper violence. The SA had forced him to carry a sign that read, "I won't complain to the police anymore." Siegel had protested at the Munich police headquarters against the unlawful arrest of his client, the Jewish owner of the department store Uhlander, and for this reason became a victim of Nazis running amok. He was not the only courageous Jewish lawyer. Nazi authorities tried to prevent Jews from documenting the persecution. The police president in Riesa, Saxony, prohibited the local representative of the Central Association of German Citizens of Jewish Faith to take pictures of anti-Jewish signs in various Saxonian towns. Yet in June 1934, Adolf Vogel photographed his father's store in Sondersleben, Anhalt, plastered with boycott signs. Dora Franken defiantly posed next to two signs that read, "Dogs are not allowed," and "For Jews, no access," at the entrance of the public pool in the small town of Blaubeuren in southwestern Germany. And in the small town of Groß Gerau, Hesse, Martin Marx documented his family standing next to an anti-Semitic slogan defacing his father's property in 1935, just before he left Germany for the United States. A picture of Lizzi Rosenfeld, a Jewish girl, on a Vienna Park bench marked "Only for Aryans," documents three offenses at once: sitting on a forbidden bench, allowing someone to take a picture of this rebellious act, and smuggling the negative out of Germany. The Spitzer family later donated the photograph to the United States Holocaust Memorial Museum. During the violent pogrom of November 9th and 10th, 1938, commonly known as Kristallnacht, Jewish individuals responded in a variety of ways to violence and vandalism. Some saved religious objects or private goods. Others documented the wreckage in pictures. In Berlin, police arrested Andreas Kirschbaum for photographing damaged Jewish stores. Thousands of private Jewish homes were vandalized, and when Heinz Bauer came home from work to his apartment in Mannheim, he could not believe the extent of the destruction. He took several pictures and smuggled them out of Germany when he emigrated to the United States. Hans Sachs documented his demolished family apartment in Nuremberg. After the war, he attached the photographs to his claim for recompense to the Bavarian authorities. Many German and Austrian Jews documenting crimes and expressing criticism were denounced, subsequently arrested, and later tried and punished. In the midst of the Sudeten crisis in September 1938, Willy Rothschild said to witnesses in public, "Today you are laughing. Who knows who will laugh soon?" He was first incarcerated in the Buchenwald concentration camp until May 1939. Later, the special court in Bamberg sentenced him to 4 months in prison for this offense. In his verdict, the judge characterized his public statement as impudent. The impudent Jew, trope or reality? The impudent Jew, der freche Jude, is an anti-Semitic trope, which Holocaust historians are very familiar with. Hitler and Goebbels frequently used it. There is no precise English translation for the German word frech, particularly as it was employed in the Nazi period and the preceding eras. Traditionally in Germany, to be frech means to be assertive and argumentative to the point of rudeness. It had legal implications, since such speech was perceived as an insult to the honor of the person on the receiving end, as many defamation prosecutions in Imperial and Weimar Germany demonstrate. I have chosen the somewhat musty and imperfect English word impudent because it captures this sense of an act of self-assertion perceived as a violation of another person's status. We find the term impudent Jew in slogans smeared onto store windows, as well as in police and court records. In administrative reports at the time, the SS, Schutzstaffel, Gestapo, and mayors often complained about impudent Jews. For example, in March 1935, the Gestapo in Aachen reported that the number of Jews who had sent letters and protested in person has become quite numerous and in their tone often impudent. The county commissioner, Landrat, in Schluchtern, wrote in his March and April report that Jews had started to act impudent again. In a similar manner, the president for the Prussian state Hesse complained in his May-June report. In July 1935, the Gestapo in Arnsberg reported frequent denunciations that the Jews would get impudent again, as did the police in Steinach on the Saale River during the same month. Historians have held that the frequent complaints about the impudent Jews allowed the Nazis to justify harsher measures against the Jewish population in Germany. However, most of those complaints referred to actual acts of Jewish resistance. In its July 1935 report for Berlin, the Gestapo emphasized that Jews were born with disrespect for state and authority. In the same month, during which week-long anti-Jewish riots disturbed the capital, the police arrested more than 100 Jews, mostly for offenses against the German state and the Nazi Party. Among them was Rosalie Milzinski, who had publicly criticized the anti-Jewish riots in Berlin by saying, "Since the German state can't succeed, the Jews are blamed and attacked." However, it did not take riots to provoke individual protest against the persecution. In October 1935, the Berlin police arrested 42 Jews. In November, 57 Jews. And in December, 36 Jews. The number jumped to 73 in January 1936. Among those 208 arrests, 141 cases resulted from hostility to the state, and 61 involved race defilement, Rassenschande, the Nazi term for sexual relationships and marriage between Jewish and non-Jewish Germans, illegal since the Nuremberg Laws of 1935. Ironically, the Nazis also accused Jews of betraying their country, even though the Nazis did not perceive them as Germans. Prosecutors called treason any criticism that in their eyes amounted to a potential preparation for overthrowing the government. Until 1936, no fewer than 46 Jewish Germans, among them 11 women, had been prosecuted or tried for treason in Nazi Germany. Born between 1887 and 1917, these Jews from Breslau, Frankfurt, Cologne, Berlin, and other cities received sentences between 3 months in jail and 15 years in a penitentiary, Zuchthaus. In various Bavarian towns, police detained 25 Jews for alleged subversive, Staatsfeindliche, attitudes and actions between January and October 1936. In its report for 1937, the Security Service of the SS mentioned the incarceration of several impudent Jews in Stettin. In September 1938, when Germany found itself at the brink of war with Czechoslovakia over the Sudeten territories, the Gestapo detained various Jews in cities such as Berlin and Vienna, as well as smaller villages like Buttenhausen, Bigge, and Huisten, for criticizing Hitler's warmongering and new racist laws. Instead of being simply thrown into a concentration camp, as is often wrongly assumed, such impudent Jews were usually prosecuted and put on trial at special courts for treacherous attacks on the Nazi state. They received sentences from several months to years in prison for their alleged crimes. When released from jail before Kristallnacht in 1938, many immediately fled Germany, which often saved their lives. Some Jews might even have considered assassinating Nazi leaders. In November 1937, the Gestapo in Treuchtlingen, Bavaria, informed the prosecutor in Munich that Bernhard Behrmann, a 64-year-old Jewish cattle dealer, had allegedly offered 10,000 Reichmarks to an acquaintance to kill two local Nazi party leaders. In June 1938, a Gestapo report claimed that Dr. Bruno Glaserfeld, the head of the National Association of German Jews, Landesverband Deutscher Juden, in Berlin, had criticized earlier Jewish illegal activities because they failed to overthrow Hitler. In a gathering with like-minded companions, Glaserfeld propagated the idea of simultaneous bombings of Nazi leadership meetings, such as during Reichstag sessions and the annual party convention in Nuremberg. The Gestapo also reported that sales representatives Günther Salter talked about assassination attempts as the only effective political means against the Third Reich. Salter suggested monitoring streets frequently used by Hitler during public events, such as his birthday celebration. The Gestapo report underlined that both Jews declared that these plans illustrated the desperation in the Jewish communities. Aware of such potential danger, Nazi authorities required Jews to surrender any weapons they had. Although the possession of guns had been prohibited in Germany since the 1918 revolution, and a 1928 law provided a few exemptions for permit holders, some Jews had kept weapons from their service in the World War, and others owned guns for hunting. In a few cities, such as Breslau, Jews were ordered in 1933 to surrender their arms immediately. But in Berlin, the police began to disarm Jews during the fall of 1938. Jews were summoned to the nearest police precinct to hand over their guns and swords, even if they had a permit. In a special action, Sonderaktion, police raided Jewish homes to search for legally registered weapons and arrested arms-bearing Jews for being hostile to the German state. Alois Adler was arrested on October 3, 1938, after he gave his hunting rifle to a friend to avoid it being found at his home. Immediately after Kristallnacht, police raided Jewish homes in many towns to search for weapons. On November 11, 1938, the Nazi government ultimately prohibited German Jews from owning firearms and any cutting or stabbing weapons. Despite or because of the impact of the violent pogrom, the authorities continued to complain about impudent Jews. The Nazi Party even used the trope in propaganda posters to justify the mass imprisonment of 30,000 Jews in concentration camps after the pogrom. When the war against Poland began on September 1, 1939, the Jews displayed a more provocative attitude, according to a circular sent to local Gestapo branches in Berlin on September 6th. In Dusseldorf, the local Gestapo issued a decree blaming Jews for neglecting orders and not acting with the necessary restraint in public. A month later, the Gestapo mandated the county commissioners to arrest, in an uncompromising way, all Jews breaking rules or displaying a detrimental attitude toward the Nazi state. In an April 1940 report, the Reich Main Security Office emphasized that it had received information about the impudent attitude of Jews from various corners of the Reich. Later that year, Jews were arrested for impudent behavior in Munich and for visiting forbidden premises in Vienna. Archival records and survivor video testimonies from the USC Shoah Foundation Visual History Archive confirm that many Jews ignored prohibitions to visit public libraries, parks, swimming pools, and movie theaters everywhere in the Reich. After the invasion of the Soviet Union, impudent behavior of Jews multiplied further in Bohemia and Moravia, according to a report circulating in the Reich Protector Office at the beginning of July 1941. In Germany proper, the security service of the SS also complained about the provocative demeanor of Jews. In response, German and Czech organizations demanded to mark the Jewish population with an armband displaying a Star of David, like in Poland. Karl Hermann Frank, the Reich Protector's deputy, wrote to the head of the Reich Chancellery, Heinrich Lammers, that the introduction of armbands for Jews would be appropriate because of the challenging attitude of the Jews. He pushed to bring this to Hitler's attention. Subsequently, the notorious Yellow Star, identifying and stigmatizing Jews, was introduced in Greater Germany, including the Protectorate of Bohemia and Moravia. The decree, which also forbade Jews from leaving their hometowns without permission, was put into effect on September 19, 1941. From this point on, all Jews older than 6 years had to display the star on their clothes in public, even during forced labor. The mandate did not help, though, in changing the attitude of Jewish men and women. In Vienna, the daily Gestapo reports reveal that on almost every other day in October 1941, the police arrested a Jewish man or woman, whether for verbal attacks against the Nazi state, unruly behavior, or ignoring local anti-Jewish measures. In Berlin and Vienna, dozens of Jewish forced laborers allegedly committed sabotage and refused to work. Alfred Schirinch, a forced laborer, resisted wearing the notorious Yellow Star and visited restaurants prohibited for Jews. Although some survivors talked casually about not wearing the Yellow Star, making it sound more like an adventure facilitating access to forbidden places, such as a movie theater, in reality, not wearing the humiliating badge resulted in serious consequences. In the fall of 1942, after a year of mass deportations, when only 55,000 to 60,000 Jews remained in Germany proper, a substantial number of 1,200 of them served sentences for political or criminal offenses in prisons and penitentiaries across the German Reich. Individual protests against wearing the Yellow Star confirm that only a radical change in perspective allows us to grasp the full range of individual Jewish behavior during the Holocaust. The forgotten stories demonstrate that the Nazi authorities perceived individual Jewish protest, contestation of Nazi laws and propaganda, and defense against violent attacks as resistance, and they punished such actions harshly. These acts, therefore, need to be integrated into our standard narrative of the Holocaust. Toward a broader perspective of resistance during the Holocaust. Although many know some details about the Jewish fight against anti-Semitism in Germany before 1933, Jewish resistance and the persecution of Jewish resistors after 1933 have sunk into oblivion, despite the existence of some scholarly work on organized efforts at defiance, such as the Herbert Baum Group in Berlin, which attacked a Nazi propaganda exhibition in May 1942, provoking mass reprisals against the Jewish population. The public, and even many historians and psychologists, still subscribe to the idea of the Nazis having led the Jews like sheep to the slaughter. Associating Jewish Holocaust resistance exclusively with organized and armed groups such as the Warsaw Ghetto Fighters and the Bielski Partisans underscores their rare occurrence and thus reinforces the notion of Jewish passivity. It is not that historians have not discussed the topic. Historical commissions established by Jewish survivors all over Europe collected evidence and documented the impact of the Nazi crimes, which in itself was an act of post-factum resistance. The Black Book, The Nazi Crime Against the Jewish People, published in 1946, contained a 50-page chapter titled Resistance, countering the notion of passivity by presenting examples of Jewish revolts in ghettos and death camps. But it neglected to mention Germany proper and dealt with resistance mostly in terms of organized group activities. Marie Serkin's 1947 book on Jewish resistance in Europe offered a strikingly similar account, focusing on parachutists, partisans, and ghetto fighters in Eastern and Southeastern Europe. However, she briefly explores art, education, and historical documentation as the Struggle of the Spirit by Jews in the Warsaw Ghetto, as well as Jewish rescue efforts in the Netherlands. In The Destruction of the European Jews, 1961, Raoul Hilberg said there was an almost complete lack of resistance among European Jews. Israeli scholars immediately challenged such assessments by emphasizing moral and spiritual resistance in the ghettos in Poland. Nevertheless, academic discussion soon settled on armed resistance in the Eastern occupied territories. In Perpetrators, Victims, Bystanders, 1990, Hilberg did discuss how some Jews refused to adjust to the growing persecution by hiding, escaping, resisting, or committing suicide. However, he emphasized the rarity of these occurrences, somehow still clinging to a traditional view of group resistance. Consequently, a thorough evaluation of individual Jewish resistance is missing in almost all prominent Holocaust accounts. Surprisingly, even in those focusing on the integration of Jewish voices, such as the widely acclaimed books by Saul Friedlander. Friedlander even asserted that the execution of German plans in Europe depended on the willingness of the victims to follow orders, as if their alleged passivity had enabled persecution and murder. To evaluate Jewish behavior, most scholars have relied on serial political reports that originated in Nazi institutions, on written testimonies of survivors, and more recently on Jewish diaries. Yet reports produced by the SS, the Gestapo, civil servants, and Nazi party officials for their superiors rarely mentioned resistance of Jews, because in their worldview it conflicted with the dominant anti-Semitic stereotype of the weak Jew and the Nazi quest for total control. Out of fear of Nazi censorship, criticism and defiance were almost entirely absent from Jewish diaries and contemporary letters. In post-war testimonies, survivors and witnesses left out such acts because the authors themselves defined resistance in a traditional way, as organized and armed acts. German authorities, however, harshly punished Jews for the smallest individual actions. In December 1934, a special court in Saxony sentenced Walter Mayer to a year in prison for saying in public that Hitler would behave like a hysterical lady. In a stark difference from how they viewed other political enemies of the Third Reich, such as communists and social democrats, many prosecutors and judges saw Jews only as guests in Germany, who needed to behave with particular restraint. After the Reichstag in Berlin, the home of the German parliament, was destroyed by a fire, the Nazi-controlled parliament passed the Enabling Act on March 23, 1933, handing Hitler unprecedented powers to govern. 2 days before that, President Paul von Hindenburg had issued a decree prohibiting treacherous acts against the government of the National Awakening to criminalize any type of political opposition. Special courts were established across Germany. In December 1934, the Nazi government enacted the Law Against Treacherous Attacks on the State and the Party, and for the Protection of Party Uniforms. The special courts, with the exception of the People's Court and the main regional courts, Oberlandesgerichte, received jurisdiction under the new law, providing them with sweeping powers to prosecute protests against the regime, now deemed as political offenses. Historians have overlooked the fact that special courts not only prosecuted political enemies, but also widely employed the treacherous attacks law to punish any type of criticism expressed by Jews against the Nazi state and its persecution. Since the separation between private and public spheres as well as the protection of private homes, soon ceased to exist in the Third Reich. Courts sent Jews to jail even for critical comments they made in the privacy of their own apartments. Although only a handful of Jews still lived in the Sudeten district after its annexation to the Third Reich, the special court in Eger tried Jews in 17% of its cases in 1940. The same special court also punished Jews more harshly than other defendants, although the special courts in Troppau and Leitmeritz, both Sudeten, did not treat them differently than other opponents of the Reich. In some cases, special courts, as in Freiburg, Saxony, did not allow Jewish lawyers to represent their clients because of the political nature of the offenses. Hence, the treatment of the Jews expressing criticism depended on the prosecutors and judges in each individual courtroom. Moreover, not only special courts, but almost every local and regional court in Nazi Germany tried Jews for criminal acts. Historians have yet to appreciate how these court proceedings can reveal patterns of defiant behavior during the Third Reich. Jews not only opposed a wide range of anti-Jewish decrees and measures, but because of the circumstances also broke both German and specific Nazi laws. However, the traditional assumption of a steady Nazification of the judicial system and law enforcement from 1933 on is too simplistic. The reality was more complicated. Some accounts reveal surprising acts of solidarity with Jews. Police officers offered help, witnesses testified favorably, and judges acquitted Jews even late into the war. Every denunciation of Jewish acts of defiance or protest needed proof in court. Despite the common myth, most of the time, with some exceptions, the Nazis could neither jail a Jewish man or woman nor incarcerate them in a concentration camp without proper legal procedures. If accusations could not be corroborated, judges either dismissed them or acquitted the defendant. Interestingly, the new broader perspective emerging from the diverse set of new sources revitalizes older ideas about resistance. Shortly after the end of World War II, the survivor Philip Friedman outlined future scholarship on the persecution of the Jews and listed multiple forms of resistance, including spiritual, moral, individual, collective, spontaneous, and organized. Similarly, survivor Meyer Dvorchetsky reflected early on multiple categories of resistance, economic, medical, cultural, and moral. He promoted the concept of Amida, stand, which he described as encompassing all expressions of Jewish nonconformism and all the forms of resistance and all acts by Jews.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.